Welcome back to Network X. Tonight we're discussing the Washington State galley workers who are still struggling for their jobs, trying to keep their jobs up against the deadline that's coming up at the end of this month, whereby they might be out of work. To help us understand how the struggle has evolved over the last several months and to bring us up to date on some recent decisions, we have with us two representatives of the Inland Boatmen's Union. To my immediate left, Dennis Conklin is the business agent for the passenger industry of the Inland Boatmen's Union, and to his left, Jay Ubelhart, a rank and file member, also a member of the executive committee on the Inland Boatmen's Union. Thanks, both of you. Welcome to the program. Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Peter.
Let me get started with just sort of a brief history of how this galley worker struggle got started. I mean, there are 130 members of the IBU that have a contract with Sodexo, which is the chief vendor in the galleys aboard the Washington State ferries. This kind of originates back, it sounds like, in 2000 when Sodexo was trying to change the contract because they were running into financial troubles. Can you kind of put this in context for us, Dennis?
Since 2000, Sodexo has been meeting with the Washington State Ferries, asking them for different concessions on the vessels. They asked them for a break in the percentage they pay. They asked them for concessions in the hours that they operate, if they could close galleys. Certain galleys on certain vessels closed them down earlier than the operating times, and the Washington State Ferries had rejected all of their requests. So Sodexo had been meeting with the IBU at different times since 2000, and we have given them different concessions at different times to help them through this period of time.
What kind of concessions has the union given Sodexo?
Manning on the vessels, how many people they had to put on the vessels at different period of times. Outside of what the contract recommended, we gave them different galleys. We allowed them to close the galley out of Port Townsend. We allowed them to close the galley out of Anacortes to give them concessions to be able to meet their budget requirements.
So you were making an earnest attempt, it sounds like, to meet them at least halfway here.
Well, we met them on every issue they came and discussed with us. We at least met them 80% of the way.
Okay. And in terms of their negotiations with the Washington State Ferries, you're saying the opposite is true.
Well, we met with the vice president, Mr. Grant, with Sodexo. He informed us he had been meeting with the Washington State Ferries since 2000 and that they would not give him any concessions. And in 2003, they had been informed by the corporate office that they had been losing X amount of dollars and that they were to notify the Washington State Ferries that they wouldn't be continuing the contract at the present.
This Mr.
percentage.
Grant is an executive at Sodexo,
yes.
Or a manager at Sodexo?
Yes, he is.
So Sodexo's head office basically told them because of the losses that they've been suffering that they had until 2000, the fall of 2003, to make it a profitable situation?
Well, they had been telling them since 2000 that they wanted them to leave, that they wanted them to close the galley. But they had been trying to make it with different concessions that we gave them. And then at the end in 2003, when their percentage went up to 10.5 and the economy was they were doing pretty poor in the economy, they informed the Washington State Ferries that they wouldn't be continuing the contract.
Okay, so this contract with the state of Washington that Sodexo's held, since they took over for Marriott. This includes a percentage of their take on food and beverages that are sold in the galleys.
Correct.
And what was that percentage back in 2000?
Well, the percentage is risen at different levels from 5% up to 10.5%.
And most recently, Mike Thorne and the upper management of the Washington State Ferries, Mike Thorne is the CEO of the Washington State Ferries, requested a much higher percentage for a part of the contract with Sodexo. Is that right?
Yes, they requested, when they put out the new RFP, right, they requested 50% of the and different concessions within the galley. There were seven different concessions, and part of that was hot foods, the vending machines, and they were requesting 50% of the gross amount.
So 50% of the gross for food and beverage and alcohol sold out of the galleys, is that right?
Yes.
And prior to that, it was, the most it was 10.5, or no, 10, or 10.5.
It was 10.5%.
Okay.
Yeah, those, it wasn't 50%, the new RFPs were not 50% of the galley operation. They split, it used to be one vendor. Sodexo had a contract where they did everything. But the state of Washington split it into seven different contracts, one of which would be onboard food service, essentially the food service in the galleys now. One of them would be onboard and onshore pop machines, of which the state wanted 50% of gross, onboard and onshore hot drink and food snack machines, of which they wanted a percentage. Like, they split it up in the percentage for each product.
So those are, those 50% numbers, though, those are extreme. I mean, I don't know of any other, anywhere in the private sector where those types of
Those are pretty extreme. If you go back to 1989, where Restora bid and took the contract away from Marriott at that time, which Marriott became Sodexo, right, mm-hmm. at a later time, they bid between 21 and 34%. And after a year and a half, they notified the ferries that they weren't going to be able to continue the contract, and that is the period of time in 1991 that Marriott took the contract over.
And now Sodexo, on during a much tougher economy, and this is after, of course, September 11th, ridership in general has gone down over the last couple of years on board the ferry system. So the numbers that they were anticipating just simply aren't there. And at this time, it's the state of Washington, the ferry system has basically asked them for a much higher percentage. Is that my
correct.
Understanding?
They were asking them for a higher percentage than they were paying at 10.5. And if they could make it at 10.5, how are they going to make it at a higher percentage than that with the new RFP?
So before we get on to where that leaves us now, what's your gut feeling as to what could they be thinking? I mean, these are... these seem to be counterintuitive kinds of requests here on their part.
Well, our feeling was they were trying to force the union out, right? To bring people in with the for a lesser wage, believing that the lesser wage would give them a higher profit. But what they didn't anticipate was that everyone has to have a merchant marine document, has to meet certain criteria with the Coast Guard before they could come. And to find that kind of help was going to be very difficult in this type of environment.
Because all the galley workers have these merchant marine documents and they go through the required basic safety training just to be able to work in these galleys.
Yes.
Okay. So they increase the percentage. Sodexo, of course, doesn't bid on this new request for proposal, nor do any other vendors?
Well, Sodexo bid on the RFP.
They did.
But they left an open end on the percentage amount. They didn't fill that in. They sent them a proposal to accept, but without a percentage in, and the Washington State Ferries rejected that.
I see. Were there any other companies that bid on these contracts?
No one else bid.
Or these proposals? No one else bid.
No.
So at this point, or up until recently, the request for a proposal round one basically got nowhere.
Correct.
Okay. So the current contract, or it's actually an extension of the current contract with Sodexo, is going to expire at the end of the year.
At December 31st.
Okay. And at that point, there will be no ferry service on board any of the Washington
State. There'll be no concessions aboard the vessels.
Aboard the vessels, okay. I'm sorry, yeah, no gas. Okay. So there was, there's a new round of proposals being discussed, or a new request for proposal process has just begun in the last few weeks. What do you know about, what can you tell us about that?
Well, the ferry system put out a questionnaire first asking why everyone didn't bid for the proposal, why everyone didn't bid on the first proposal. And then they sent out a second proposal, right? RFP, mm-hmm. requesting different people to mm-hmm. bid on it. And they hadn't received any responses back up until this period of time.
So they know nothing more than they did at the end of the first round then at this point?
Correct.
No one's changed their interest in.
Well, I think everyone was waiting for a ruling from the Marine Employees Commission to see what position the union was going to be in.
Okay, because the union, let's put that in context, filed an unfair labor practice charge several months ago regarding the initial round of the initial request for a proposal round, which was missing any language in it that protected the workers as being members of the union, correct?
Correct. We filed an unfair labor practice that clarified that the Washington State Ferries had an obligation to negotiate the effects upon employees when they were leaving them out of the RFP, which they had an obligation to negotiate their wages, hours, and conditions, which the Washington State Ferries refused to do.
And this is a first in all the years that they've had this galley service. But prior to that, they've always maintained a union presence in the galleys. Is that
they
right?
had maintained a union presence until 1991 when they bid out the contract. They or 1990 they left us out of the RFP. At that period of time, they had a concession manager named Barry Firth, who had been authorized by the upper management to enter into negotiations with us that the RFPs from this period on would make sure that they contained the union in them, mm-hmm. a concession ship.
Okay.
For the employees.
Okay. But this, the galley workers have been IBU members. They go back for quite a while, though.
To 1950.
1950, okay. So now we have an MEC hearing, a Marine Employees Commission hearing that just came down in answer to your unfair labor charge that was filed several months ago. What was this hearing? What did the Marine Employees Commission decide, and how has this affected the process? Before you get to that, though, let's explain that the Marine Employees Commission is kind of like a local labor relations board for these types of issues.
Well, the Marine Employees Commission has the same authority as the National Labor Relations Board. They were part of PERC back in 1988, and then they separated them from PERC, and they have their own commissioners at this period of time.
All right. What was their decision on this charge, and what's the impact been so far?
Their decision was that the Washington State Ferries violated the rights of the employees by not negotiating the effects upon them, and they ordered them to rescind their RFP, and they had to put out a new RFP, including that the employees would be part of the RFP and the contract. The CBA would be part of that RFP.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And has the has there been new language? Has there been a new RFP submitted by the state, or are they still just responding?
Well, the Washington State Ferries informed us that they were going to send out a new RFP, including the employees in it, the union employees.
So they're not challenging this decision?
Well, they said they were going to file a protest against the decision with the MEC.
What does that mean, Dean?
A review. They're going to request them to review their decision.
Mm-hmm. And this is being done with state taxpayer dollars?
This is being done with state taxpayers' money.
Okay. Jay, kind of help me put this in a larger perspective. What, because of all of this, we wound up with the potential loss of the galley service and the loss of some revenues here. that the ferry system had been, you know, relying on for several years.
Yeah, well, the latest figures that I know of, I mean, in the last year, the state took in $1.2 million as their take of the Sodexo operations because it was on a percentage of gross, not a percentage of profits. Otherwise, they would have gotten zero. So the galleys are now going to close. The state, the RFP that just pulled back wasn't due until, I believe, February 8th or 10th. They've said that they didn't expect any galley service till April, March, whenever someone new could get in there. So for 3 to 4 months and possibly longer, there'll be no galley service, and 11% of zero is zero. So it's money the state will lose. It'll inconvenience passengers. Yet again, 130 people will be out of their jobs and will most likely, due to the MEC ruling, be hired back by whichever, if any, concessionaire gets the contract.
Okay, so they'll be coming back as union employees into the galleys. And there's a loss of revenue over the next 3 months. The state's going to take a hit on that, or the ferry system going to take a hit on
which, even if they go into boom months, I mean, they'll never make it back. It's almost, you know, if you go out on strike, you never ever make the money back that you didn't earn.
Okay. So how much money do you think they'd have to make in the next several, in the next year to cover their losses here, you know, for these next 3 months, if that's all it is?
Well, if you're making $1.2 million a year, right, in January, February, and March are the lowest months, and you're going to lose approximately, if you didn't have a galley there, you possibly lose $400,000. So to make up that percentage, you're probably going to have to make somewhere close to $1.6 to $2 million to make up that difference.
Any possibility of that happening?
Well, I don't believe there's a possibility.
Okay.
You know, there's been also part of this, which may have been one of the reasons why they decided to split up the contract. You know, it's part of the overall ferry plan, the 5-5-5, 5% increase in fares, 5% reduction in costs, and 5% increase in outside revenues, which could be from anything, higher percentages from concessions, selling the smokestacks on the boats, you know, for
advertising.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and, you know, this may have been one component. Oh, we'll get people to pay more and, you know, boost our 5%. But due to the economy, due to the last couple of rounds of raised fares, ridership is down, plain, flat out, and simple, you know, and hasn't recovered to the levels it was in even 2001.
It seems like a pretty odd time for the management at the ferry system to be tinkering with this type of a contract. Couldn't they have waited till, you know, the economy's recovered or ridership goes up again? I mean, those are certainly realistic possibilities over time, but they took a pretty big risk here, it seems like.
Well, the current CEO, Mike Thorne, he was brought in for just this sort of thing. Yeah, he has a track record at the Port of Portland, not only at Swan Island, where he sold the largest dry dock in the Western Hemisphere, you know, and sold it to a private company, which turned around and sold the dry dock and made millions. And he did the same thing at the Portland Airport, subcontract, breaking up a one company contract providing the food services at the airport and, you know, bringing in smaller vendors.
And did he succeed there?
I'm not sure what the current situation is at the Portland Airport, but it is broken up into smaller, you know, your little Made in Oregon store and your, you know.
But the Port of Portland, the dry dock you were referring to, that was obviously a publicly owned facility.
Yes, owned by the Port of Portland.
Okay. And he, in turn, sold it off to private enterprise.
In a no-bid situation.
No open bidding on that, and it resulted in a definitely a big loss in terms of its true value. Is that what you're suggesting?
Or? Yeah, they sold the shipyard at Swan Island to the company that was operating there for $27 to $28 million. They turned around and sold the dry dock for $23 to $24 million. and get to keep the land.
I see.
And the Port of Portland doesn't, you know, have either a dry dock or of that size or the land.
Okay. So Thorne is up here now, appointed by the, or hired by the, is it Doug McDonald?
The Transportation Commission.
By the State Transportation Commission. Okay, it's like a five-member body.
Yes.
Okay. Do you know if he was their first choice, or?
I'm not sure if he was their first choice.
Okay. But it seems, and he's actually a Democrat from Oregon, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. A very conservative one, it would seem.
Very conservative.
Right. He also has interests in land in Eastern Oregon and Pendleton, Oregon.
I can't speak on that.
Okay. Jay, do you know anything about that?
That he's a farmer in Eastern Oregon and apparently gets quite a good check from the federal government to not grow wheat or not raise cattle, whatever it is he doesn't do.
Okay. So he definitely gets Department of Agriculture subsidies for that operation. So he's okay with a public subsidy for his own private interests. It seems like in this case, he's interested in taking a part of the public domain here in Washington State, i.e. the Washington State Ferry System, and beginning or making efforts at least to privatize portions of it. And that's the argument that's here in terms of, that's the only rational explanation you could think of in terms of what's going on in the galleys with these 50% interest requests.
Well, I think you have to take a look at his overall 5-5-5 plan. It's kind of like someone, you know, sent him to school, he read a book, got to the first page, right, and said, hey, here's how we do it, 5-5-5. And it doesn't go any further than that. Because what you see is on the passenger-only boats, mm-hmm. you know, he wanted to sell the passenger-only boats off, right? Mm-hmm. The legislators came in, gave him a proposal to keep on the Bremerton and the Vashon, the vessels, for 2 more years. They were to sit down with the unions, negotiate concessions on the manning, on the vessels, to keep them running. We entered into negotiations. The first meeting, the Washington State Ferries informed us that they were directed by the upper management that they weren't going to discuss the passenger onlys, that they were going to sell them off. And that's what they did. They never intended to keep those boats. Even when they went to the legislators and informed them, they were, and then they sold them off. And the passengers are the ones that are losing out, because they'll never replace those boats.
These are vessels, obviously, that were paid for by state tax dollars.
Yes.
And actually also some federal
state
money
and
as
federal.
Well. Yeah. And the Tyee, which used to run between downtown Seattle and Vashon Island, has just been sold off. Was it on
eBay?
eBay, is that right? For $500,000?
I think it was $560.
Yeah. And the company that bought it, some outfit in Florida, I believe, a broker in Florida, has turned around and sold it for like over $700,000 or something like that.
Correct.
Okay. And this is money that does not, well, all right, this is money that's lost right there.
Correct.
Okay. And there's now, is the rest of the fleet been sold off, or they still have?
They still have some of the vessels left.
Okay.
But their intent is to sell them off.
I see.
Because I'm in negotiations now, and I do the negotiations for the Washington State Ferries, and we're not really in discussions about the passenger-only boats. It's the least of their concerns. So the feeling of the committee is that those boats are going to be gone, because they're not going to negotiate a reasonable concession to keep those vessels there.
Okay. So we're running out of time. Let me just kind of get you both to summarize a little bit. It seems like this is Michael Thorne and upper management at the Washington State Ferry System that's sort of taken a corner of the ferry system and kind of, I don't know if it's too far to characterize them as mismanaging it, because it seems to be potentially resulting in a net loss of revenues for the state-run ferry system. Is that right? Would that be a fair statement?
Correct.
Okay. And the employees, 130 galley workers, members of the Inland Boatmen's Union, have been kind of going through a lot of turmoil over the last 6 to 7 months?
Well, most of the galley workers on the ferries have been there. I think I have, you know, about 70% of them have been there 10 years or more, right? They're mostly women, single mothers supporting their children. And, you know, the Washington State Ferries had no concern about laying them off or putting them out of work.
Okay.
Why they increased their management.
Yeah. While they're at the same time increasing.
Correct. They've added management positions.
So downtown, the Washington State Ferries headquarters, they've added management personnel.
Yes. Or they have three different buildings now. You go to Pier 52, you can go to the Coleman building or 2911. There's approximately 300 managers and administrative in the Washington State Ferries compared to, if you look at the deck department, including the terminal, there's 750 people.
So in terms of areas to cut costs, these weren't obvious places to perhaps start?
Well, they seem obvious to us.
Okay.
Right, seems obvious to us. I've been there since 1979. When I first began, there was one port captain. There's now four port captains. They pay those port captains travel time and mileage to come to work, right? Seems like a high waste of taxpayers' money.
Travel time and mileage to just come to and from their job.
Correct.
Every day.
Yes. In the terminal department, they've increased management. It used to be 2 to 6 for the same job with less people in the terminal
less
department.
Less employees in the terminal department of the ferry system, yet they have more managers.
Yeah, they've added 4 more.
Supervising.
Correct.
A smaller number. Okay. Well, we're out of time, but you've given us plenty of good information to think about and perhaps revisit this situation after the end of the year. We'll stay tuned and try to keep tabs on it and see if the galleys actually go dark and if the unions succeed in securing those jobs. Thank you both very much for joining us. Thank you all for watching. As always, stay informed and get involved. And this is Network X. Have a good evening.
The world goes in circles.